everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. We are gardening after Christmas. It's unbelievable. It's still warm this morning. When we woke up, it was 52 degrees out. And as you can see, no snow. But that's okay. It's coming. We're not too worried about it. It gives us a chance to actually finish digging up the carrots that we couldn't get to at the end of October because there was 5 inches of snow. So I'm going to just finish this up, and then maybe we could take a little walk around and show you what our garden looks like in December with no snow.
That sounds like fun.
This year we planted multicolored carrots. So we have red ones and white ones and orange ones. You can see they are still green on the top. If this weather didn't get too much colder, they'd still be green and growing. Now I did cover them, but after the fact with straw, just to see if we could preserve them and see if I could keep the soil warm enough so that I could dig them, but I couldn't. Now this is a perfect example. This top part was up in the frozen area. This bottom part was still under the soil. This is nice and firm, so I just need to cut this off and it'll be perfectly fine.
They are really super sweet.
They are. Now with these, some of them got way too big in the first place, but that's still a good, it'll be fine, it'll be tasty, and once it gets cleaned up, still workable. These giants up here. Now the other day when I tried to do this, I couldn't get the pitchfork in the ground.
Too frozen?
Mm-hmm. Look at that. That's a beautiful carrot. This one looks like a turnip.
My goodness.
It isn't. It's a carrot.
Wow.
Now, whether this is sweet or not, I don't know. That remains to be seen. This is probably one of the ones that went to seed.
So you think this will be the last of them in here?
Yes. Sooner or later, the weather is going to turn into actual winter. This is a red one.
I'm amazed the soil is still that loose.
Well, it wasn't. But with all of these high 40s and low 50 days, it's thawed out. Look, there's even an earthworm. Semi-dormant, but still alive.
Like a yellow one down here right below me.
Mm-hmm. I think there might be still some over here though.
I think as long as you're out here, I'm going to have you rototill the whole garden.
Not funny, Richard. It's an orange one. Now, even this part that was above the ground and froze, maybe it was the straw, maybe it was because it was closest to the wood framing, still firm and good. It's a white one. These, I think, are the sweetest of all of them, the white ones.
Well, I must say I was very impressed the other day when you brought some in. Probably our neighbors are going to look at us and thinking, what are they doing in their garden?
There's more in here than I thought.
So how many carrots would you say you harvested this year?
100
or more?
Oh, I don't think I had that many.
But they were big. I mean,
yeah, they are huge. Well, We didn't get into this part as much as we probably should have. So they just They grew as big as they wanted to grow. Anybody else?
Yep.
I think that's it. Or not.
Are you gonna make some juice?
We could do that. Make carrot juice.
Yeah.
I had that in a while. Now, unfortunately, the beets were not as tolerant as the carrots. And when I was digging those up, another white one got pushed over there.
I think there's some more over there too. In that cluster.
Yeah.
Are they solid?
Yeah. I think I pushed those over there when
there's a real tiny one over next to the wood. See it? Yep.
Good eyes. See what happens when you have bionic eyes?
Well, it's amazing. After having that LASIK surgery.
No, you had cataracts.
Or cataract surgery. It was amazing how bright things were, and I no longer had to wear any glasses at all for reading or working on the computer. I still, out of habit, I reach towards the top of my head to adjust my glasses or find my glasses, and then realize, oh, I don't need those.
Now here's an example of a beet. Now this would have been a beautiful golden beet, but it's soft. So beets were not as cooperative as the carrots.
Well, you could put those in the compost bin, right?
Yep.
So, now all is not lost.
I feel better about that, because I felt badly that I never got out here to get the carrots because of the winter weather that came too soon.
Well, plus all the other things we've been trying to accomplish this year.
Yep.
But.
Well, you ready to take a little walk around the yard?
I think we should, yeah, because this is most unusual.
Showing.
Yeah. Well, we had 25 bales of straw brought in so that we could start covering areas that we don't grow anything in, which really helps keep the weeds down.
Now, I could keep this open, I suppose, and let the critters get in there and harvest what we harvested, but I'm not. I don't want them to get into that habit. So I'll just close it up for the winter. There you go. Here's my pile. My pile of carrots.
So our December harvest.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, that really is.
Behind me you can see where we have hundreds of bags of leaves that people have dropped off. Our neighbors have shared, and this is where we had our blackberries, our melons, our squash, and our sunflowers over here. And in those white cages you see, that's where we have our latest blueberries and one honeyberry. Now over here we still have raspberries. We left them there. We were trying to keep them under control. And in the spring, we'll go in and we'll take out all the dead canes. It's an ongoing thing because raspberries love to grow and they are very happy in the soil.
And they're delicious.
And they are delicious and they're great for you.
So, now, just because you cut all the blackberries down doesn't mean we're going to eliminate them by any means.
No, and you might wonder, well, why would they even bother doing this? This is an area of our yard where Canadian thistle loves to grow.
Yeah.
And if you don't keep that under control, it will be everywhere. And we're doing the best as we can to get rid of that by suffocating it from sun. And it'll show up again, just like the blackberries, but this helps.
Well, maybe we should have a thistle garden.
I don't think so. Although thistles...
They are beautiful.
Thistles are good for you. Yeah. They're, you know, they make supplements for people out of thistles, but
do the birds love them?
I don't know. I suppose they like the seeds of them.
I don't think so, yeah.
But this is how this area looks. And we've trimmed our grapes way back also. So we're going to see, give those a new start next year also.
Well, every year we keep saying we're going to get those grapes under control. And do we?
We did this time.
Well, yeah.
Afterward, a new year. This closed-in area is one of our places where we do experiments or plant plants, flowers that we don't want chewed on. These are Montauk daisies here, and we have talked about moving them, but at this point we haven't yet. And we also have a couple of tree peonies, hybrid tree peonies, that we don't even know what color they are or what shape the flowers will be because they haven't yet flowered. These, if you know Montauk daisies, you don't chop them down in the fall. You cut them back in the spring, and then you can take the cuttings and stick them right into the ground and start new plants. That's how I did this entire bed. So while they're looking ugly right now, they will be beautiful.
The roots are doing well. In fact, those stalks will continue to grow and
yes.
get green.
Yes, they will.
It's amazing.
Yes. It's fun to see other people's backyards once winter gets here. During the summer, it's all overgrown, and you really don't get to see what's going on in your neighbor's backyard. This is our neighbor Greg's house, where he has created this forest himself, and we enjoy it. And one Saturday, we saw a 10-point buck.
Yeah. Just grazing right along, and mm-hmm. I slowly crept up to this post right here where the birdhouse is.
Mm-hmm.
But every time I moved a foot, it would pop its head up and kind of look my way and just keep grazing. And eventually, when I got to the post, he jumped over this fence and ran through the backyard between the houses.
Very cautious.
So.
Now we've put our Liberty Garden to bed for the winter. These we just left open because there's nothing in here at this point. I had a little bit of straw left over, so I put it there. Over in that corner are all of our asparagus plants. So I covered them with straw. And in this one, there are still some orange milkweed seeds, or plants that we grew from seeds last year. So I just covered those over. Just give them a head start for next season.
Well, did you want me to enclose this area and then you could have a year-round greenhouse?
No, thank you. Once all of the ferns are gone, you can really see what this area looks like. Because once the ferns are up, they take over. This is our little pond. This was frozen solid. Now, it's moving and floating because it has been so warm. There were times when I've seen squirrels running right across here and yesterday when Logan was here, he was playing with this floating piece of ice as his mother and I watched, hoping he wouldn't get his shoes all wet, which he didn't. We had a lot of fun this year experimenting with our ginkgo tree, and you can see on the ground, these are what ginkgo leaves look like if you don't know what they look like. In the summer, they're green, then they all turn yellow, and then they fall off in 2 hours. But if you look up into the tree, you can already see all the buds for next year. Waiting patiently.
Well, it is an amazing tree. I'd say the girth right now is, what, about 15 to 18 inches?
Oh, at least, yes.
How old? About 30?
Yes, it's about 30 years old. Mm-hmm. I'm waiting for a branch strong enough to put a swing on.
Hmm. Well, the squirrels love it up there. Because
the squirrels love it. There is a nest up there. This,
way
this
up
summer,
in the...
we kept seeing little branches falling out of the tree, trying to figure out what in the world was going on. Well, they were constructing their nest. And every morning when we open the shades, we can see them running around. Also in these trees behind you, Rick, it is like a squirrel paradise. You can see them
jumping from tree to tree, bush to bush,
everywhere, because there's two rows of cedars, and they love it. They absolutely love it. Now over here is our waterfall, and that too has been frozen. Now this one is not frozen all the way down yet, because down here on this end, it's about 4 feet deep.
You want to jump up there and see how...
No, I do not. Mm-mm. No, because if you look over there, when I push on it, there are air bubbles in there. And you can see the white, that's where I have my...
The bucket, yes.
The buckets that have...
But look at these leaves as they're just embedded into the ice. They're beautiful.
Mm-hmm. And then this is one of our swamp plants.
It's growing.
Now, yes, there are still fish in here.
No, and we couldn't catch them.
No, we can't catch them anymore in here. If it stayed mild like this, some of them would survive. If it gets down to 20 below again, like it probably will, then unfortunately they won't make it through the winter.
Well, we only put feeder goldfish in here for the main purpose of keeping mosquito larvae down and out.
And they do a great job. We wanted you to see what our wooden arch looks like in the winter time. So this is when we can actually see the structure of it. And no more morning glories until spring, maybe. But again, these are Montauk daisies. They are so tough that they can survive in that bucket through the winter, even though it's not buried in the ground.
Well, look, you even have parsley that's still growing.
Yes, the parsley. Still growing, because this is a south-facing wall and this is an east-facing wall, and I have harvested this several times. I have dried it. I've used it fresh and they're still green. This is our south garden, the original one that had the rabbit-proof fence in it. And during the winter, I use it as a place to bury my plants that I have in pots that maybe are not big enough to go into the regular garden areas, or we're experimenting like with our ginkgo trees. All of our little baby ginkgos are over there. They're under the leaves. There are more over there under the leaves. This is just a compost bin full of wonderful leaves that are composting even though it's winter. Again, more straw.
What do you mean composting even though it's winter?
Well,
it's gonna think of those leaves. We had a 6-pile high leaves, and when we came out in spring, they were down to about a foot.
Right. Well, what I'm saying is they're still working in the composting business because they create their own heat.
You have a composting business?
Yes, for our garden.
Oh.
And straw for next spring to put as a mulch and during times when we need more straw for our strawberry patch, it's handy. But the strawberries are all put to bed. Now in the spring when they do start coming up, I'll take that straw off, push it into the pathways so I have a nice dry, clean area as a pathway that will deter some of the weeds from growing. And then I'll put it back in around the strawberries as a mulch.
So is that why they call them strawberries?
Exactly. You've got it. Okay. And here's that archway that was so full of morning glories and cypress vine that you couldn't even see that there was a structure.
Well, we had to physically take it out of the ground to get all of those vines,
tendrils.
Those twining vines.
Right.
Oh my goodness. That took us a good hour just to get them off of this one.
Yes, that would have been a hilarious video.
Yeah.
But then we moved it too, because during the winter, we're shoveling the driveway. It would be in the way, piles of snow. It makes more sense to put it over here out of the way.
And we'll move it back in spring.
Yes, we will. Now, if you're looking over here, these were we had all of our buckets with our flowers, our daffodils, and our tender bulbs. And up there on the little hill is where the hardy hibiscus are.
And we're moving those.
We are moving them. Yes, we keep saying we are.
We don't know where yet, but...
Right. But we will.
They will find
a
new home.
We'll be trimming back that honeysuckle and also that clematis. There are certain kinds of lavenders that do really well in the cooler times, and then there's many of them just go dormant when it gets too warm out. This was a variety called Phenomena that does well regardless of what time of year it is. And you can see it's like an evergreen plant, but it stays green even in a drought season. And it smells...
Nice.
Smells wonderful, even now. Would you like to smell?
Yes, I would. Everybody,
big
put your nose up to the television set or your TV monitor or your cell phone.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
It's pleasant, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
I think I'll put it in my pocket. As many of you know, we do not cut down our grasses in the wintertime. I love the architectural verticalness of them as winter interest. This is a flame grass, it's called. And this is just, it's so soft and so fluid. It just blows in the slightest wind.
Fluffy.
Yeah, it is. And then this is another hibiscus. And some of you may recognize Liatris. Now, these were some that I did not strip the seeds off, but if you have Liatris and you want to move it to some other place, those are the seeds in there. So in the ground they go.
Well, one of the things you have is plenty of Liatris growing around, but I
really?
Understand that's one of your favorites. So
well, and the bees like it.
Yeah, I know.
And the butterflies
There's
like
another
it.
One.
Yes, I know, this whole bush. You know, eventually they get big like this. And if you don't cut them down, they just are staying there, and eventually all of these will come in contact with the ground. Now, if you have a lot of mulch, like over there, if we tried planting them there, I would have to clear away some of the leaves so that it comes in contact with the ground. If you just look at this corner and you see the different kinds of grasses that are still up, you can see that, you know, there is an interest here. Now, that brown scraggly thing that I now am going to be cutting down today, I don't like. That's interrupting my pleasure points about this corner. But the grasses I like, even the sedum. If you didn't get a chance to cut your sedum down, that adds interest. It's not just...
Oh, it's a textural
leaves.
Difference.
Right.
Contrast.
It's a textural, right. And this is a burning bush, which now you have to be careful when you're buying burning bushes to make sure they're not the invasive kind. Ours has not been a problem because the deer and the
antelope.
I was gonna say buffalo.
We have buffalo, Tatanka.
The deer and the rabbits often chop this down for us, so we don't have to do that. But you have to be careful with burning bushes. But there's the sedum again. Another burning bush. This is our giant fleece plant. This is the one that I'm objecting to, and this will be cut back today. On the very, very corner, we still have our fine line buckthorn, which stays upright like that. And these are golden spirea bushes, which add another contrasting texture, more Liatris here. And look at that. This is columbine. Columbine is one of the toughest flowers. If you look in here, look at that. This weather has not stopped that at all. They're amazing. This is a possible place for us to be moving the hibiscus to. This would get sun all day, and that's what they like.
Yeah, and I think it would be very impressive here during the blossom season.
Yes, it would. Yep.
And we do have space for it.
Yes,
I see
do.
One of our sculptures fell over.
I see it did. Oh, look what else is still coming along. Mullein, Rick's favorite.
Well, it is an impressive plant.
It is soft. I mean, when it's little, it's soft.
Don't you still have one growing at the end of the driveway? Or
it's not actually growing. It's still standing there. And somebody lost a glove, and it was sitting down on the ground. I thought, well, I'll just put this up on top of the mullein. Maybe the person that lost the glove will actually see it and take it, but no one has. Now, again, because the ferns are gone, you actually can see how high these mounds are. And these were created only with leaf mulch. Mulch that people dropped off, or leaves that people dropped off, that have turned into the richest soil you can imagine. And we know that come spring, there are tulips and there are daffodils in here that will just pop out and be absolutely beautiful.
Yep.
Another plant that is still green, Sweet William. Sweet William is another one, if you have space for it and you want color and something that is reliable and will come back, Sweet William will do that.
Well, that plus your, along the driveway, the...
Burrow's Tail?
Burrow's Tail, yeah.
Yes. As you can see, this with the snake willow gone, even in the wintertime, there's a lot more sun that can get to the soil because of the snake willow being gone. And that's why we are rethinking what will be in here, because what we have here, like hostas, are not going to be happy now because there is no shade for them. So the hostas will have to move, and some of the other things. And, you know, we're thinking maybe a fruit tree.
Well, I'm looking at grafted apple trees, mm-hmm. 5-in-1 different kinds of apples on a single tree, grafted tree. And if because they only get to be about 6 foot tall, I think we may have 3 of them in here.
Or a peach.
Well, I think if we're going to have a peach, we're going to have a couple of them. Or maybe the peaches go here and the apples go elsewhere.
You never know.
But big difference.
Yes. Just in case you hadn't seen what our snake willow was like and how big it was, these are some of the slices that we had them save for us. So you can see it was a large tree, very large. And even though you can't probably see it, we planted a maple at the same time as we planted this snake willow. The maple is so much more slow growing, and the snake willow much faster. But Rick has ideas for this. He's thinking of making sitting
toadstools,
he calls them. And this would be the top of the toadstool where you would actually sit on it. So you're thinking,
well, I'm going to use, I think, a 6x6 post into the ground, probably a 6-footer, where I have about 4 feet underground, and then actually router in a square to match the 6x6 post, probably take it in a couple of inches, and then use Gorilla Glue. And once it's in place, then I'm going to start sanding it down, the top down, and then we'll probably use a polyurethane, an exterior poly,
yes,
to kind of keep them in nice shape.
And look what's doing so well right next to it. This is Rick's very favorite, help me with the name of this one.
Daphne.
Daphne, thank you. It is a semi... evergreen, so it will stay like this for a long time. Maybe towards spring it will start losing its leaves and then new ones will grow, but
well, remember the when spring, the rabbits last year burrowed underneath and basically killed the root system?
So all of these dead branches will be coming off, but we wanted to give it enough time to see if they would
recover
or not, and I think not, so those will be trimmed off. If you enjoyed this part of our video, we think maybe we're going to have to do another part, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that. And as always, if you have comments or questions, helpful tips, we'd enjoy reading those. And if you'd like to become part of our garden family, please subscribe on this little orangey red button over here. And we'd also like to invite you to enjoy the weather with us and stay tuned for part 2.
And hope everybody had a wonderful Christmas and looking forward to an amazing 2020. Everybody in good health, happy, and prosperous.
Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.